Hi guys, so in this video we'll be learning how to apply the ANOVA test in Microsoft Excel. So first, to understand what ANOVA is, ANOVA is the abbreviation for analysis of variation or the analysis of variance. Okay, so now to understand what ANOVA stands for is, let's say that we have, let's take an example that we conduct an experiment, we conduct a survey. And while conducting the survey, it is very much possible that some variation might have crept into our data. So the ANOVA test basically allows us to find the causes of these variations that have crept into our data. Now these causes could be of two types. Now the first one is the assignable causes and the next one is the random causes. The assignable causes, of course, are those causes which due to which the variation occurs and is under the control of the human hand. Okay, we can minimize those specific variations. Let's say for an example that we use the that we use the incorrect model for the data, or we use the incorrect distribution for the data, so due to which some variation might have crept into our data, but that can be controlled. So that is why it is under the assignable causes. Okay, now for random factors, let's say we conduct an agronomical survey, let's say we measure the yields due to different weather conditions. Now these weather conditions are not exactly under our control. Therefore, these weather conditions are called the random factors, due to which some variation might occur in the data. Now, ANOVA can be of a few types. The first one is one factor ANOVA, or the single factor ANOVA. Now, it means that the data is being affected by only one factor, and we'll be doing that in this video. There is also another type of ANOVA, two-way ANOVA or the two-factor ANOVA. There are multiple factor ANOVA as well, but they are very difficult to apply. Okay. To understand what ANOVA is, how to apply them, and what one-way ANOVA is, let's say that we have this hypothetical data here. Now in this question, we have been given that some students were given drug treatments before their test when they were revising for a test. Okay, so some were given a memory drug which might help them learn better, some were given a placebo drug, some were given no drugs at all, and their scores on the tests are given to us here. Now we want to check if the memory drug is effective at all or not. Okay, so these kind of questions that you will get in one way ANOVA. Now if you see, there is only one factor affecting the scores, which is the drugs which have been administered to the students. Now of course it is possible that the scores are affected by how the teacher teaches or how many hours the teacher teaches, but we are not considering that in this case. Okay, so if we consider those factors as well, this question, this problem might convert into a two-factor ANOVA. Okay, so now before we start applying the ANOVA test, we first need to form the null hypothesis. Okay, now what is the hypothesis? Hypothesis is simply a statement which has not been proved yet. Okay, now what is null hypothesis? As the name suggests, null hypothesis is a statement which nullifies the claim in the question. Let's say in this question we are given that the memory drug is actually effective. So the null hypothesis would be that all the treatments are equal, or the memory drug is the same as placebo drug, or in other words, it's not effective at all. Okay. Now I could also say that all of the means are equal. The means of students with students scores with memory drug and placebo drug and no drug at all. All of these means are equal. Okay. So we have been provided with five students in each sample here for memory drug, placebo drug and no drugs. Okay. So let's set up our null hypothesis. Null hypothesis is defined as H naught and can be formulated as, let's say, all treatments are equal, or let's say that I am assuming the means to be x1, x2 and x3. So our null hypothesis would be x1 equals to x2 equals to x3. Okay, so now there is another kind of hypothesis which is called the alternate hypothesis, or and that is denoted by H1 or HA for alternate hypothesis. Now alternate hypothesis of course is just the opposite of this statement H naught. Now that would be the that all treatments are not equal, of course, or x1, x2 and x3 are not equal. Okay, now all means are not equal. The statement does not necessarily mean that all of the means are different. It might mean that x1 and x2 are different, but it could also be that x1 and x3 are same. It could be like x2 and x3 are same, but x1 is different. Or it could also mean that x1, x2 and x3, all of them are different. Okay? So, our null hypothesis would be all means are not equal. Or that the means differ significantly from each other. Okay, so these are the these are the alternate hypotheses. Okay, so now to apply the ANOVA test in Excel, you have an additional add-on that you can simply download from the Microsoft Store now, and it will do all of the calculations for you. You don't have to find any value manually. Okay, so to add that add-on, you simply need to go into Insert, select Office Add-ins from here. A dialog box might appear, and inside this you can download the Excel Miner. Type in search for Excel Miner. Now you can see that here is Excel Miner Analysis Toolpacks. Click on this, and I have an option to add here, but I have already downloaded it, so I'm not adding it again. Just press add and you will get it, and you can see it on your Excel. Okay, so let's just go back. Now to use this tool pack, we need to click on to Office Add-ins. Now here you can click on My Add-ins, select this Excel Miner Analysis tool, and here you can see there are many other options that you can use, that there are many other things which you can use from this tool pack. Okay, so now here we are using the ANOVA single factor. Okay, so inside input range, now here you need to select this data here on which you want to apply the ANOVA test simply. Okay, now we are selecting grouped by as columns or rows. Now columns, because we are using columns because the groups are being listed in columns. or you can also use rows if data is arranged like that. Now we select the labels in first row. It makes the system understand that the first row here has the names of the groups. Okay. Now there is also an alpha value. Now alpha value by default is 0.05, which corresponds to 95% of confidence level. Okay. And the 5% is the significance level. Okay. Now 95% confidence level, what does that mean for us? Now it means that if, let's say, if we conduct an experiment 100 times, and so that there are 95% chances that our result is true, so, or we are confident about 95% of the results, therefore we say that we have 95% confidence level. Or you can say that we have 5% significance level. Now if you have 5% significance level, the alpha value is 0.05. Now, some standard alpha values are 0.05 and 0.01 and 0.1. 0.1 is 10% significance level, 0.01 is 1% of significance level. Okay. Now by default the alpha value is 0.05 here. Let's not change that. Now inside output range, now you simply need to select a large area. Just select any random large area and click OK. And that's it. You get the values here. Okay. Now you have many values here. So first we'll need to understand what these values mean. Now then, you can use these values, these three values, F, P value and the F critical value, to derive your conclusion. Okay. So first, to understand what this table means, we first need to understand how the variations, how the variance creeps into our data. Now variance can creep into our data in two ways. It could either be the variation inside this group, or it could either be that there is variation between these two groups and these two groups, or anything. Okay, so therefore we have sources of variation here, sources of variation as between the groups and within the groups, and here in this table here, let's try and make sense of this. Now these groups are listed here: memory drug, placebo and no drug set up the names. Now count 5, 5 and 5. These are the sample sizes. Let's count these. These are 5. So it just so happens that the sample sizes for memory drug, placebo and no drugs are the same, which is 5 here. It does not necessarily has to be. Now this sum represents the addition of all these values. It is 417. Let's just verify that as well. To verify that, we type in equal to. We type in the word sum. Select this function here. Inside brackets, select this data and press enter. You get 417. You can see that these are the same values. Now again, we calculate this one. We use the same formula. Inside brackets, select this, complete the brackets and press enter. Again, the values are the same. We found this value as well. Hence, the data is verified, that 83 again. Okay. Now these averages, of course, is simply 417 divided by 5, which gives you 83.4. 250 divided by 5 gives you 50. 83 divided by 5 gives you 16.6. Now you have also been provided with variance here. Variance can simply be calculated using variance.p or variance.s function in Excel. Now let's see this table here. Okay. So This SS is abbreviation for the sum of squares. Okay, so these sum of squares due to variation in between the groups. We can calculate this by hand as well. And for it, the formula is this here. It is the sum of the t squared values divided by the n, small n, and that is being subtracted by CF. CF is the correction factor. Okay, so first we'll be needing a lot of values. For t, t is simply the summation of all these values which we had calculated earlier. Now small n is the sample size, which is the count value here, 5. Therefore small n is 5. Now capital N is the number of observations that we have drawn from the data. So it means that the number of values in this would be our capital N. Therefore we can calculate this using the count function. We type in equal to, we type in the word count, select this function, and inside brackets select this data. Complete the brackets and press enter. You get the value of n as 15. Now g is the simply the grand total of all these values. Okay, to calculate that we type in equal to, we type in the word sum, select this, and again select this whole data. Complete the brackets and press enter. Okay, now the correction factor is defined as g squared divided by n, g raised to 2 divided by capital N. Okay, so let's just try and calculate that. We type in equal to, we select this value here, multiplication sign, we again select this, divide sign, and then we need to select this value here, capital N, and press enter. You get the value of CF. CF is the correction factor here. Now coming back to the sum of squares due to variation between the groups here, we can try calculating this as well. Now it is simply the sum of the t squared values. T is, we have been provided with the values of t. So let's just try and calculate this. We type in equal to. Now we need to sum the values of t squares. Okay, so therefore we'll use the function sumsq. Sumsq simply squares the values and then adds them. And inside these brackets, we select these three values, complete the brackets. Now we need to select sum squared and then divided by small n. Small n is 5 here. Now we need to subtract CF from this value as well. Let's put a bracket for precedence. We need to subtract this CF here, therefore minus, and we select this CF here and press enter, and that's it. You get the value. Now you can see that these two values are the same. Okay, now this error rate, now this the variation within the groups is called the error variance. Now this error variance is caused due to the random factors that we had discussed earlier. Okay, now this error variance cannot be reduced, while we can reduce this variance though. Now to calculate the error variance, it is actually quite difficult. Therefore we can simply calculate the total variance and then subtract these two values to find this value. Okay, for total variance we have this formula here, which is the sum of the x squared values and then we subtract the correction factor from it. Now x is the values that we have been provided with, the data, simply the data. Okay, these are the x values. We need to square these up and then add them, and from then we need to subtract the correction factor. So let's try calculating them. we type in equal to. Again, we need to use the function sumsq. We select this function here. Now, inside brackets, we select this data here, complete the brackets, and from this we need to subtract, therefore minus sign, and then select this value CF and press enter. You get the value of as well. Now you can see that these two values are the same as well. Okay, now we calculate the error variance. This can simply be calculated by equal to sign, select this minus this and press enter. That's it, you get the value as well. Now there is also a column of DF. DF is the degrees of freedom. Now these degrees of freedom can be calculated by a simple formula. Okay, so these degrees of freedom for variation between the groups can be calculated by finding the number of groups that we have been provided with. What are the number of groups that we have been provided with? 1, 2 and 3. These three, memory drugs, placebo and no drugs at all, these three are the groups that we have been provided with. Therefore, the formula for degrees of freedom is simply the number of groups minus 1. Okay, so therefore we can calculate it as 3 minus 1, which is 2. Now this number of groups is denoted by the value small k. K is 3 here, therefore the degrees of freedom is k minus 1 always. Therefore the degrees of freedom are 2. Now we can calculate the total degrees of freedom by a simple formula, n minus 1. What is n? N is the number of observations that we had chosen. Therefore 15 minus 1 is 14, and we have that formula here. To calculate the error degrees of freedom, we can simply subtract this and this, and we'll get the error degrees of freedom. 14 minus 2 gives us 12. Now we proceed further. This column represents the mean of sum of squares. Okay, so this value 5577.8, this value has been obtained by dividing this and this. So in a sense we are calculating the mean of sum of squares, therefore the name mean sum of squares. This also is calculated by this dividing by this. So let's say we want to verify this. We type in equal to, we select this here and divide it by 12 and press enter. That's it. See, you get the same value, hence it is verified. Now this F value has been calculated by dividing this MS and dividing it by this. Okay, let's just verify that as well. We type in equal to, we select this formula here, this value here, divide sign and press enter. You get the same value again. Okay, now based on solely this value, we cannot derive a conclusion out of it. We also need a p-value, we also need a f-critical value. Now p-value is, as you can see, is very quite small here. Now this f-critical value can be obtained from a table, or from a standardized table. You can download that table from anywhere on the internet. Now this value of f is called the calculated, the value f calculated. Therefore let's just rename this as f calculated. Okay, now this f critical value is called the f tabulated value, because it is derived from the table f tabulated. Okay, now we need to understand that this value here, the degrees of freedom, this value is called the df1 value, and this 12 is called the df2 value, and here we have the f table. You can download this from anywhere. Okay, now I'll just show you how to read the values. The df1 values are listed here horizontally, and the df2 values here are written vertically here. Now the p values, the p values or the alpha value are listed here, and you have the f calculated value for some standard degree, for some standard significance levels. Let's say we want to find out 0 points at alpha of 0.05. Therefore, we read this line here. We need to read this line and find the number corresponding to 12 degrees of freedom and 2 degrees of freedom, which is the value 3.89 here. Okay. Coming back, now here you can see that if tabulated is 3.88, which is fairly close to what we calculated, we read now. So therefore, F tab is also verified. Now, we have understood all of the values. Now we can derive conclusions from it. Okay. Now there are two conditions. You can either reject the null hypothesis that we had defined earlier, or you can accept the null hypothesis. If F calculated is less than F tabulated, we accept the null hypothesis in this case. If F calculated is less than F tabulated, or simply you can say if the p-value is greater than the alpha value. There are two conditions in which we can accept the null hypothesis. You can use either one of them. If F calculated is less than F tabulated, we accept the null hypothesis. Or if P is greater than alpha, we accept the null hypothesis. Let's check if this condition is true. F calculated here is 50 and F tabulated is just 3. Therefore, F calculated is greater than F tabulated. Therefore, we reject the null hypothesis. Or you can say we failed to accept the null hypothesis. The null hypothesis to us was that all treatments are equal. We reject this null hypothesis. Obviously, it means that we accept the alternate hypothesis, which was that all treatments are definitely not equal. All means are not equal. Okay. Which is a very obvious result, since you can understand this by just looking at this table here. It simply means that this drug, memory drug, is somewhat effective in increasing the memory power. You can see that there are vast differences between the values. We have 97 here, we have 3 here. Okay. So by just looking at this data, you can intuitively understand that this memory drug is surely effective. And that is what we have proven with ANOVA test. Okay.